Hello and welcome to Set Theory, a bite-sized lecture series. In these videos, you'll get a conceptual overview of set theory that doesn't take all day. If you're new to this channel, be sure to check out the playlist with all the videos in this series, which I'll link to in a card in the corner of the screen. Today, we're going to learn about 6 of the 10 axioms of set theory. But first, what are axioms and why do we need them? In simplest terms, an axiom is a statement that we accept as true, even if it can't be proved. That sounds kind of scary, right? But actually, for the most part, axioms are like definitions we use to build out the universe that we live in. They can't be proved not because they might not be true, but because they're so simple and fundamental that it doesn't really make sense to try to prove them. The most famous examples of axioms are Euclid's postulates, a collection of 5 rules about geometry that Euclid came up with around 300 BCE. To illustrate the idea, here's Euclid's first postulate. A straight line segment can be drawn joining 2 points. So, as you can see, axioms are like the atoms of math from which all other theorems and rules are derived. There are certain branches of mathematics that study structures built from different sets of axioms than the ones we commonly use. Those are outside of our scope right now, but on the other hand, isn't that kind of what set theory is? You could say that an axiom of algebra, geometry, calculus, etc. is that numbers exist. In set theory, we do use numbers because they're very useful, but we don't necessarily have to. We've expanded our universe outside of that axiom, so that now we can say, I want to do math with cats, and everything still works the same. Alright, enough of that. Let's learn about some axioms of set theory. The first axiom of set theory is called the Axiom of Extensionality, which is a very fancy name for something we already know, which is the definition of two sets being equal to one another. If you want a refresher on the definition of two sets being equal, I will link that section of lesson 1 in the card above. This axiom, and a few others, basically take definitions we already know and formalize them as rules. So last week, our definition of A equals B was, for all x in A, x is in B, and for all y in B, y is in A. The axiom of extensionality says, for all A and B, A is equal to B if and only if, for all x in A, x is in B, and for all y in B, y is in A. That is, I'm telling you as a rule, that for any two sets, we can tell if those sets are equal using this definition. Axioms 2 through 5 are what I like to call the existence axioms, although I don't think that's an actual term. The first existence axiom, which is the second axiom overall, is the empty set axiom, which simply states that the set with nothing inside it exists. The formal way to say this is, there exists some set B, such that for all x that could possibly exist, x is not in B. Next is the pairing axiom, which states that for any two elements x and y, we can construct a set that contains both of these elements and nothing else. That is, we can construct the set x, y. In formal terms, we would say, for all x and y, there exists some S such that S equals the set of x and y. Next, we have the power set axiom, which states that the power set exists. You can click on the card above for a refresher on the power set from video 1. In formal terms, we would say, for every set A, there exists some set B such that for every set S, S is in B if and only if S is a subset of A. All the members of B, all the sets inside of B, are subsets of the set A. The final existence axiom is the union axiom, which states that for any set of sets A, we can construct a set containing all the elements of all the sets in A. For example, suppose A is a set containing the set 1, 2, the set 2, 3, the set of the set of 2, and the empty set. The union axiom states that we can remove the second layer of brackets and take the union of all of these sets. So this would become the set of 1, 2, 2, 3, the set of 2, and nothing, since there's nothing inside the empty set. Then we get rid of the duplicate terms because we don't need them. Note that we do get rid of 2, but we don't get rid of the set of 2 because the set of 2 is different from 2. So the only duplicate we have in this example is just 2. This set that we have now, 1, 2, 3, and the set of 2, is called the union of A, or the union of all the sets in A. There are plenty of problems dealing with union A in the example problems linked in the description, so be sure to go check those out. Another way to think about union A is union A equals the set of all elements that belong to at least one set in A. Similarly, we can think about intersection A as a set of all elements that belong to every set in A, and you'll see that we use these ways of thinking about it a lot when we do proofs in the example problems. The last axiom of set theory is called the subset axiom. It states that given some set A, we are always allowed to take any subset of A based on some condition. For example, let A be the set line, triangle, square, and cube. The subset axiom tells us that we can construct the set S containing all elements of A that are two-dimensional, which would be triangle and square. Note that this condition doesn't have to be a rule like being two-dimensional. The condition could literally be all elements of A that are either a line, a triangle, or a cube. So our subset would be line, triangle, cube. The important part is that we're picking elements from A to put inside our subset S. Another example is intersection. A intersect B is equivalent to the subset of A containing all elements of A that are also elements of B. The original set is A, and the condition is being in B. Now, officially, this axiom is actually considered to be multiple axioms, which are called the subset axioms. The idea behind this is that for each potential condition, there's an axiom saying that we can create a subset based on that one condition. So, for example, in the intersection example, we have an axiom saying that we're allowed to create a subset of A with the condition that all the elements are also in B. But that distinction is not really important right now, so I'm just going to keep treating it as one axiom. And that concludes this shorter second video of this video series about set theory. I hope you enjoyed it, let me know what you think, and if there's anything that would make it better. Also, make sure to check out the example problems in the description. Thanks for watching, see you next week!